Hello, and welcome to the Nintendo Power Retrospectives. I'm Count Zero. We are one issue away from the end of Nintendo Power's third year, with issue 23 for July of 1991. As Nintendo Power has switched to a monthly publishing model, they haven't received and tabulated all the votes for the Nestor Awards, so this issue we don't have the results yet. It'll be next time. But what we do have is an expanded Game Boy section in addition to our usual NES coverage, so we've got a lot of ground to cover. Let's get started. Our cover game for this issue is Power Blade, and we get a mix of some original painted art and some game background in the cover. It's an okay cover, but it's nothing really to write home about. It certainly doesn't have the same level of detail or effort to it that some of the diorama covers we've had in the past have done. For the letters column, as of press time this issue, Operation Desert Storm was underway, a transition from Desert Shield, which was just keep the Iraqi army from moving out of Kuwait into Saudi Arabia and straight into retake Kuwait and push into Iraq. So because of that, this issue, they're running letters from U.S. soldiers who brought their Game Boys with them when they were sent overseas for Desert Shield. It's kind of interesting. We get a few more iconic and famous letters about their Game Boys and the durability thereof once we get into after Desert Storm has completed and the soldiers are coming home. Also, we get some pictures from the winner of the Final Fantasy Treasure Quest contest, who won an adventure in the U.S. Virgin Islands. If you are the winner of this contest, or one of the winners, and you are watching this episode, I'd like to hear you talk about the contest and discuss how it went and what you remember about it. My email address is in the closing credits, or also, if you'd like to post in the comments, feel free. I'd like to get in touch with you. I'd like to interview you about this. Our first game this issue is our cover game, Power Blade. This game and Street Combat, which I may be talking about later, are probably some of the worst examples of what I call de-Japanification in video games. Basically, taking a video game with elements that the U.S. publisher considered too Japanese, usually manga or anime-styled art, and stripping those elements from the game in favor of replacing the game with more American art designs. Usually this entails replacing characters with muscle-bound pastiches of Stallone or Schwarzenegger. In some cases, this can get quite costly, as with Power Blade, Taito, the game's developer, even redid this game's cutscenes. The game has the player fending off an alien invasion by taking out the forces of the invaders in 7 different levels before a final boss fight. The article has maps of all 7 levels and strategies for the final boss fight, along with a rundown of power-ups. Now, Power Blade is an interesting action platformer. It combines the run-and-gun action of Contra with the freedom to pick your own levels of Mega Man, with basically your only weapon in the game being a boomerang, which you can upgrade with a multi-shot. The game also manages to sort of prevent you from cheesing it with a turbo shot on your controller by having the power of your weapon's attacks being tied to a power meter, holding down the weapon charges up the shot for the weapon. So if you're using a turbo button, you're not getting as much power to your shot, and thus not being as effective as you would if you were properly managing the charge on your weapon and that sort of thing. You could still deal with a whole bunch of weaker enemies with turbo, but tougher enemies, if you're using turbo to try and beat them more easily, you're kind of out of luck. The controls themselves are generally pretty good, though I'd prefer if the game gave you some sort of in-game map, whether on the main screen itself, in a small mini-map at the corner, or in a sub-screen to tell you where you've been in the level, as enemies respawn after you've scrolled their spawn point off-screen, sort of like in Ninja Gaiden. All in all, I enjoyed the game, though I'm not sure if this is something I'd go out of my way to hunt down. Next is Howard and Nestor. In this issue, our dysfunctional duo is playing Deja Vu. As you would expect, Nestor tries way, way too hard to be a hard-boiled private detective, and it ends up getting him into trouble. Next up is Totally Rad. This is a game that was also de-Japanified, but not to the same degree as Power Blade was. As the original character art was retained, they instead changed the game's story to make the characters surfer dudes and dudettes to explain their anime-style hair, the big sort of hair that's kind of characterized Japanese animation and manga from the late 80s, early 90s. I'm not sure if that's worse or better than taking the time to replace a more a character with more of a traditional anime character design with someone who looks more like Arnold. Anyway, Totally Rad is a game that is odd. It's a run-and-shoot action game with some very basic platforming, and the main difficulty of this game is avoiding enemies more than anything else. The game gives the player a limited magic gauge with some abilities that will let you replenish your health, but it doesn't give you any way to recover your magic gauge. In addition, the game lets you do a charged shot, but the jumping automatically fires the shot from whatever level you're standing at, which makes the shot not very useful when you're fighting bosses, who you either have to jump to avoid, or you have to jump to hit, or both. It's not really a terrible game, but there's nothing about it that stands out either. Honestly, it's the kind of thing where if it ended up on sale on Virtual Console, where I found a really cheap copy at a thrift shop or convention or at my local independent game store, I'd pick it up. But that's pretty much the only reason why I'd buy this game. I certainly wouldn't spend like 20 bucks or what have you, or even 10 bucks on a cartridge. Next up is Classified Information, where we get stage and world select codes for TMNT2 and Adventure Island 2, respectively. Next game is Swordmaster, which is a fantasy-themed action game. The article gives info on each of the attack techniques and spells in the game, along with information on the first 7 stages, and, once again, the final boss. Now, Swordmaster is a game that is a lot harder than it has any right being. It's a game that tries to do what I describe as proto-fighting game weapon-based combat. You walk along various levels, facing generic enemies you defeat by jump attacking high, attacking at a normal level, or attacking low, and defending yourself by blocking in the same directions. Partway through each level, you fight elite enemies who you have to defeat through attacking and defending at different heights, in turn requiring more skill. In theory, this game could be awesome. All you really need is a good AI for the elite enemies, and some well-designed generic enemies with a specific pattern that they move to. So you learn the pattern for the generic enemies, and then you have to kind of outsmart the more elite enemies. This game doesn't give you that. What this game does is it adds some clunky platforming on top, some poor placement of indestructible enemies that makes the platforming more difficult than it needs to be, a limited number of continues, which, as I've stated previously, there's no reason to have a limited number of continues on a home console game ever, and some enemies where the blocking and attack height level is kind of arbitrary. In terms of sometimes they just read your mind, or rather your controller inputs, and automatically block, and you have to kind of basically attack or block faster than the controller does, than the AI can process it. Or it's just more they're just really stupid. Honestly, I recommend skipping this game unless you're really a completionist collector. It's not really worth it unless you're planning on going through the game with Game Genie cheats, which gives more power to you. Next is another informational article titled The British Invasion, one of the fairly well-written informational articles Nintendo Power has been doing lately, in this case profiling several British game developers, specifically Rare, Software Creations, Ocean, and Elite. With some of them, we get brief discussions of their history developing for the PC, but not much more beyond that. I'm presuming that this is because the writer of the article doesn't want to explain to readers what the ZX Spectrum is, since it never got a US release, and they might be confused. Or they assume that US readers might be confused when it comes to the whole issue of the Speccy. But I guess that's the main reason. So anyway, next up is the somewhat unfortunately titled, or acronymed, SCAT. A jetpack shoot 'em up, and one with the potentially legally actionable main characters of Arnold, who looks just like the former governor of California, and Sigourney, who looks just like Sigourney Weaver. The article gives maps of the first 5 stages. Well, this game isn't really that fun. It's a jetpack shoot 'em up, and that's a genre I'm generally not a fan of. and this game only gives you one life before game over, which I'm also not a fan of. Fortunately, what the game does do is give the player a life bar so you don't die in one hit, and it gives you, for lack of a better term, several options, like in Gradius, to serve as a force multiplier. However, in Gradius, your options will fire different types of shots based on what other shot power-ups you picked up. The normal forward shot, or laser, or missiles, or what have you. Whereas here, your options just fire the plain generic shot, and they rotate around you as you move, though you can lock them in place by holding down a button, or tapping a button. And they just fire normal shot. If you pick up a missile launcher, or a bomb, or a laser or whatever, the options won't start shooting lasers. So they're not as helpful as the options from Gradius. Would I recommend this game? No, not really. In a genre that's already known for its difficulty, the jetpack shoot-em-up, SCAT is less tough but fair, more unreasonably hard. We then enter the Game Boy section of the magazine with Sword of Hope, which is something of a combination RPG and adventure game for the Game Boy. The guide gives maps for the first seven areas. Sword of Hope is a game that tries to combine the puzzle-oriented gameplay of an adventure game like Shadowgate with the dungeon crawling of wizardry, and because the game only has one character in your party, so you are both spellcaster and melee fighter, it also has some elements of the original Dragon Quest or Dragon Warrior. Unfortunately, this game, in trying to be a jack-of-all-trades, fails at all of the above. The game doesn't have any sort of auto map, which means you need to be making maps of the dungeons on graph paper or just on paper, which is something not conducive for play on the Game Boy, in terms of on an actual Game Boy, not a Super Game Boy or other similar system, particularly if you're on the go, as opposed to playing at home. Further, the game is grindy as all hell. The first suit of armor you can buy costs 50 gold, and in the opening area, where you'd be doing this grinding, monsters don't drop much money, only 1 or 2 gold per encounter, if they drop money at all, and they go down quickly, but they're not saying much. Further, the cost to get healed scales based on your levels, so as you improve your level, the amount it will cost to heal up your character to full or rest, so you can continue grinding, will go up, while the amount of money you're going to be making will stay the same. Further, to put the cherry on top of this crap sundae, you also need to keep track of passwords, because this game does not have any sort of autosave on the cartridge. I recommend giving this game a miss. Now, if this thing had gotten, say, a Famicom release, or was released on the NES in the United States, as the actual physical on-console game, I'd cut it some slack for some of these things, because when you're playing at home on your console system with a controller, it's an environment that's much more conducive to note-taking, and much more conductive to keeping track of passwords, and a lot of the logistical problems that make this game not work well. The game would still have problems. As I mentioned, scaling the amount of money it costs to get healed up with your level still is a problem, but the more logistical issues in terms of drawing a map of your environments, particularly if you don't have this issue of Nintendo Power, or writing down your passwords, keeping track of those issues would somewhat be mitigated by the fact that you'd be sitting down in a stable place at home, not having to worry about accidentally losing the slip of paper or a notebook or whatever that has your passwords on it. So there's really no reason to pick up this game. I recommend you give it a miss. Next is Ultima, The Runes of Virtue, which was reviewed about a month or so ago by the Spoony One, so I hope I'm not stepping on the reviewer exclusivity period. In any case, the guide has a map of the overworld, plus some notes in a few starting areas, including the caves that hold the runes of Compassion, Valor, Sacrifice, and Justice. Ultima, The Runes of Virtue, kinda wants to be Ultima meets Gauntlet in a portable form, combining the top-down hack-and-slash gameplay of Gauntlet with the slower-paced, more thought-intensive gameplay of Ultima, something that could theoretically work in the bite-sized chunks that something on a portable system works best at, the kind of gameplay that works right on something you're taking with you on the go, that you're playing for a few minutes at a time in a waiting room on a bus, that sort of thing. This game doesn't quite pull that off. It's still kind of fun, but this would probably work better on something like the Super Game Boy, Game Boy Player, or the Retron 5, or if this were to receive a Virtual Console release on Virtual Console, either on your 3DS or on the Wii U. Next is the port of R-Type for the Game Boy, complete with maps of the first three stages. This port, the Game Boy version of R-Type, is not a good game. It is not a great port. Now, I have upgraded my computer's hardware, added memory, I'm using a less memory-intensive video capture program, and I'm running into slowdown problems. I'm not certain the slowdown here is on my end, and I ran into some significant slowdown issues. So if R-Type is chugging on the Game Boy's hardware, on the actual hardware version, that's not a good thing. That's not an argument in this game's favor. Shooters need fluid gameplay. And I didn't experience that. Further, R-Type tries to recreate the levels from the arcade version of the game and the home ports on the TurboGrafx-16 and the Super Nintendo, with all the nice, big, detailed sprites and level environments, and it just doesn't work at all. There is not enough screen real estate on the Game Boy. The resolution is not high enough to let you do this. All it really does is leave you cramped and confined and blocked in when you try to move. This isn't fun, and considering that there are higher quality ports out there, including ones that can be played on portable systems, like the PS1 version of R-Type 1 and 2, which is on PSN and can be played on your PSP or Vita, I would strongly recommend playing that version of the game instead of this one. The Game Boy is getting another Disney platformer with Mickey's Dangerous Chase. Apparently, Pete is being a jerk again, and now he's just chosen the present that Mickey was going to give Minnie, and Mickey has to get it back. Or Minnie, if you're playing as her. You can choose either one. Either way, it's nice to see Minnie not getting damseled for once. As it is, Mickey's Dangerous Chase plays a lot like Chip 'n Dale Rescue Rangers, to the point that I almost wonder if it began life as a portable Chip 'n Dale Rescue Rangers game. You run through the level from left to right, dispatching enemies by throwing blocks at them, with smaller star blocks being your star or coin or ring-esque collectible that you need to grab 100 of to gain extra lives. The game gives you the option to pick between Mickey or Minnie, though both play pretty much the same way that Chip and Dale control the same. Even some of the enemies act like enemies from Rescue Rangers, like the dogs from the first world. In addition to the good controls, sprites here are perfectly scaled to the screen. Mickey and Minnie are both have distinctly recognizable sprites, while also being small enough that you have enough information about the environment around you to make decisions on how you approach enemies and how you approach jumps. This is a competent and very fun game, and if you're looking for Game Boy games to add to your collection, this is definitely something to pick up, particularly since I don't think this is going to show up on the Virtual Console due to being a licensed title. Speaking of licensed titles, LJN has ported the WWF WrestleMania engine to the Game Boy with WWF Superstars. The game has a semi-updated roster with Hogan, Mr. Perfect, Ted DiBiase, The Ultimate Warrior, and Randy Savage on the roster. This game reminds me of how far wrestling games as a genre have progressed. Modern wrestling games, not just polygonal ones like the WWE 2K series, but sprite-based games as well, like the Fire Pro Wrestling series, give you a much better idea of where you are in the ring in perspective to your opponent, also giving you special, unique things about each character that makes them play differently and gives them a essence of what they are, of what makes them special, like signature moves and finishing moves and that sort of things. They also make it easier to break out of pins and give you more ways to win matches, like by submission. This game has none of those things. Really, you'd be much better off either importing one of the Fire Pro games for the Super Famicom or playing Tecmo Pro Wrestling on the NES, or if you're looking for something to play on the go, well, there have been two Fire Pro Wrestling games released for the Game Boy Advance inside the United States, so you can hunt down one of those games and play those instead. Next is the Game Boy version of Pac-Man. You like Pac-Man? Now you can take it on the go. Now, Pac-Man for the Game Boy is an okay port, but one with some technical weaknesses that make it an inferior port. The primary problem with the game is that the arcade version of the game, and most home ports of the game, even the incredibly bad Atari 2600 version, gives you the entire board on the screen at one time. It gives you plenty of information on how to plan your route. You know where the ghosts are, all the ghosts are, and what direction they're moving in, so you can make necessary adjustments to avoid them and get all the pellets to complete the maze. The Game Boy port, on the other hand, only gives you a small slice of the screen, which scrolls as you make your way through the maze. This gives you a fog of war that is not present in any of the other versions of the game, which in turn leaves you out of luck when it comes to planning ahead. But the worst part is the Game Boy being a monochrome system, or at least grayscale system, gives you no color information over what ghosts you're up against. Now, this is significant because if you know anything about Pac-Man, you know that Inky, Blinky, Winky, and Clyde each move differently. They have different movement patterns, and they each leave the center area at different times. Thus, knowing what ghosts are out and what ghosts are where is what you need to know in order to succeed at the game. If you really want to get how important this is and also want to be a better Pac-Man player, there's an article at GameInternals.com I'm going to put in the show notes, which dissects the movement patterns for each of the ghosts. So because of these issues, I really don't recommend getting this version of the game. Again, having mentioned it before, the fact that the PSP and the Vita can play PlayStation 1 games from the PlayStation Network store, I would recommend getting one of the Namco Museum collections for the PlayStation 1 and playing it that way. That'll get you a much better Pac-Man experience. I mean, it'll still be on a fairly small screen, but you'll have the information you need to succeed at the game, as opposed to being kind of limited by having to scroll and not getting the full detailed information for where the ghosts are. Next is Caesar's Palace, which is basically one of those semi-shovelware gambling game collections, except now with the license of a major casino. Now, casino games, one would think, are something that would be hard to mess up. Goodness knows you walk into, well, any Rite Aid or Walgreens or any other drugstore, walk past the game section, you'll find a collection of small LED blackjack games, poker games, roulette games that you can pick up for a song. It used to be that, similarly, if you went to your Office Depot or whatever, you'd find and collect, along with all the other Mahjong games and that sort of thing, you'd find a small collection of casino games. The casino game collection as a whole is a long established tradition in gaming as one of the things that you put out. And so you think, okay, we know how a casino game should work. We know how this should control, we know how the presentation should be done. It's just a matter of putting a unique skin on it to reflect whatever you're trying to do. Like, for example, Caesar's Palace, putting the idea of the Caesar's Palace Casino, giving the look and feel on there, as best as you can, of that casino. Through card backs or whatever. Casino Kid has a sort of RPG-esque element where you're trying to earn a certain amount of money at each casino to advance through the game. All this is known, it shouldn't be that hard to mess it up, yet Caesar's Palace does. The game, for some reason, decides to use a mouse interface. Use the arrow keys to move a mouse around, and the A and B keys, is basically your left and right mouse clicks, to use this on a system with a tiny screen. It requires the player to click and drag their chips one at a time to the bid area in order to play a game, as opposed to just having you select the amount you're going to bid or bet on in a menu. To put the icing on top of the poor Sutton decisions, when you're playing card-based games, the game doesn't total the cards in your hand in blackjack. It's a small thing, but every other game in this kind of medium does this. Honestly, if you're looking for a casino game, stick with something like Casino Kid. It's a much better presentation. You do get a sense of progression as opposed to just being in a casino, particularly since you're having to navigate and wander your way through the casino as opposed to just selecting the different types of games you want to play. Moving on, we have Counselor's Corner with or the Game Boy version of Counselor's Corner, with all the questions here being about Final Fantasy Legend. We have one more NES game article here, with an article on the NES port of Monopoly. Due to the game being a fairly faithful port of the board game, a lot of the advice in this article is stuff that would actually carry over really well to the board game itself. Now, Monopoly for the NES is a game that I have a personal emotional attachment to. My grandfather on my dad's side was a cutthroat Monopoly player, and I didn't play video games with him much. In fact, I only played it with him once, but the one time I did was when I played Monopoly with him and he kicked my butt. As it is, when it comes to porting board games to video game systems, we approach this taking my emotional attachment to the game out of the picture. Monopoly is one of the best games for this adaptation, as is like Risk, as much of what slows down play with these games is handling money, making change, and if you do auctions, handling those. That said, the Monopoly game for the NES doesn't incorporate some of the game's more commonly used house rules, like putting money under free parking and collecting it if you land on there, that sort of thing. For Counselor's Corner, on the NES side of things, we have questions on the Immortal and Destiny of an Emperor, and a map to help you with the warp puzzle at the last dungeon in Star Tropics. Speaking of Star Tropics, that game has entered the top 30 this issue, with Wizardry, the first game, Proving Grounds of the Mad Overlord, not 2, Knight of Diamonds, which I don't think is out yet, and Battle of Olympus returning to the rankings as well. In the Now Playing column, Double Dragon 3 is featured prominently, along with Bart vs. the Space Mutants. ICOM also has a new adventure game coming out now with The Uninvited. This is kind of particularly of note, because if you're familiar with ICOM's MacVenture series, you know that The Uninvited was actually the first game in the series to come out, with Deja Vu and Shadowgate being the next two titles in order. In Packwatch column, we have two future cover games featured this issue. Vice, Project Doom, and Battletoads. To wrap up the issue, we have the Celebrity Profile column featuring Jeremy Miller, co-star of Growing Pains with Kirk Cameron, of Kirk Cameron's Saving Christmas fame. Well, now Saving Christmas fame. However, while Kirk Cameron has leveraged his sitcom success to star in a series of various films made for fundamentalist Christians, including the currently zero on Rotten Tomatoes, Kirk Cameron Saving Christmas, Miller is working to promote addiction counseling and treatment services in California, although I'd probably suspect that they also have a sort of fundamentalist Christian bent, unless it's a Scientologist bent. My picks for this issue are, first, Mickey's Dangerous Chase for the Game Boy. Yes, that's a game that does a really good job of adapting the gameplay from Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers and making it work on a handheld platform, which is not something to sneeze at, considering how Super Mario Land didn't quite manage to pull off the gameplay of Super Mario Brothers on a handheld platform. And that's from the first-party developers, Nintendo themselves. For the NES, I'm going with Monopoly, though to be fair, that's due to a combination of my personal attachment to the game based on my history with it, and, well, lack of a better option for other games. Next time, we'll have the final issue of Year 3, and we should have the results of this year's Nestor Awards. As a heads up, because of various reasons, these episodes may slow down a bit, particularly because I'm working on a senior project, and that's going to be taking up a bit more of my time. But I will be trying to keep getting the episodes out at least once a month, hopefully get 2 out a month, keeping with that schedule. If you enjoyed this show, and also enjoy my other videos on this YouTube channel, please like the video and subscribe to be notified when the next episode comes out. Additionally, if you do want to see these episodes coming out more frequently, and I need to put my resources more into this, or just see my production quality improve for the Nintendo Power Retrospectives and my Breaking It All Down reviews, please support me on Patreon. There'll be a link in the show notes below, or in the credits, or if you're watching this on my YouTube channel page, on the upper right. Thank you very much for watching, and I will see you next time.